Please welcome Michael Keaveney back to the stage.
So a couple things we're going to go through. A presentation from our co-founder and president of products, Benoit Dagno. Before I do that, though, I think it's important as you assess Snowflake and you want to understand what it is you're doing for. I'm a peddler, right? I'm a sales guy. I'm a peddler. I peddle something. But when I make a decision of where I want to go, I want to understand, is my executive team engaged in a customer-first strategy? Do they have a great marketplace to chase after? And the marketplace here is limitless, and you're starting to get a taste for it. When you start to look at data exchange, data sharing, and what we do just on a day-to-day basis is just mind-blowing. But most importantly, you want to have a fantastic product. And what our co-founder and our engineering team have built and supported is absolutely mind-blowing. When you look at the net promoter scores that we get comparative to the rest of the industry, it's almost 2x. And that's you, the customers here. So I encourage you, as you look to it, assess us as a possibility of replacing a competitor, talk to the customers that are here in the audience and get their perspective. I'll be happy to drop you off at one of our customers' facilities and let you have a one-on-one conversation with them, because it is mind-blowing how great the product is. So with that, I'd like to introduce Benoit to the stage.
Hi everyone, good morning. So I'm going to go a little bit deeper in the products, and I will start first by giving you an overview of why we made Snowflake, what motivated us. So we were initially two co-founders, myself and Thierry Puyanès, and you know, we decided to build Snowflake, and of course it was to answer a big need. So when you start the startup, right, you need to have a big problem, a very important problem, and a problem that no one has yet solved. And that's what I'm going to explain in the first part. In the second part, I will go deeper in the architecture, and which is, you know, everyone has mentioned the architecture of Snowflake is so different and differentiated compared to anyone else. So I will explain to you how, you know, we built this architecture and what was the idea behind this. And the last part, I will really go and explain that even though we started by saying we're going to build a data warehouse to the cloud, really now Snowflake has moved, you know, somewhere beyond that. And we are, you know, rebranding ourselves into, you know, the data platform built for the cloud. And I will explain to you why we are opening Snowflake in such a way, and why we can, you know, say that we are embarking in this journey of being, you know, the best data platform in the world. So first, the genesis of Snowflake, and of course, as I said, it always starts with a big problem. And the world of data, if you look at the world of data in the last, you know, say decade, give or take, you know, plus or minus 2 years, The world of data came through a lot of changes, and the first, along you know, many dimensions. The first of these dimensions is of course the explosion of data. More and more data, and this is a big data challenge. You know, nowadays, you know, data started to be generated by humans. Now data is mostly generated by machines. The world is digitalized, and the interaction of your customers are probably happening, you know, through machines, and the log, you know, analyzing the log of these machines or IoTs is a big part of what the world of data analytics has become. The other dimension is the user, and also the explosion of the number of users using this system, and that's very important, right? Everyone wants to be data driven, and if you want, you know, your company to be data-driven, it means that probably most of your employees are using this system now. It's not only reserved to few data analysts or the C-level, you know, executives. The other trend, too, is that more and more applications, and Braze is a good example of that, really are using these systems directly. So these applications are offered, you know, online, And of course, every interaction of this application by an online user is generating, you know, queries to the backend, you know, data analytics system that adds to the concurrency. And the big challenge of more users and more concurrency is that it's not a steady like OLTP system, right? The workloads of data analytics are very spiky. And accommodating for this tag and not, you know, overpaying for that, you know, really compute on demand is very important there. The other trend is faster response, right? We are used to use our cell phone and we need, you know, immediate response. And response is both when you ask a question as a human being, you like not to wait for hours, you know, seconds is okay, minutes, okay, maybe, but hours is not good. So there is that trend, and the other part is, which is important, is that if you start to use, you know, the data analytics system for your applications, there it has to be instance, right? When a user interacts with your application and you have you issue a query against the data analytics system, you cannot wait at that point. So a really fast answer is important. And the other dimension of that is ingestion of data. So it's the time, you know, it takes for the data to be born, and generally it's born in your operational system, and the time it takes to move to your analytical system, and the time it takes for someone to query that data and have this data. So as Blaise was explaining, also it's very critical to shorten this data, because with machine-generated data, the decay of value of data is very fast. Right, so you want really to stream data, and that's another trend. More governance is also important, right? It's about security. As you have more and more data, more and more users, and more regulation like GDPR, you need really to have a very good strategy for governing access to your data. And that's very important, it cannot be open to everyone, so you have to control that. And data sharing, there was a lot of discussions about data sharing. I'm not going to spend a lot of time about the value of that, but it's enough to say that your data is not enough anymore. You need, you know, data from outside sources to make, you know, good decisions. So only having your data and only accessing your data is not enough. And so when we started, so we found this conflict in 2012, and there was, you know, no good answers to these challenges. And the first type of systems were, you know, what we call the EDW, you know, on-premise systems. So, you know, Teradata, Oracle, Netezza, IBM, Vertica, were, you know, in that category. And of course, they completely missed the big data challenge, right? They were not designed for big data. They were not designed for the volume. They were way too expensive anyway. Store, you know, such a large volume of data. They were, you know, machine-generated data is also semi-structured. So they were, you know, all the optimization that were done in this traditional database system were about rational, you know, data and not semi-structured data like JSON. So they would, you know, not really work for that type of data. Their architecture was, you know, this single cluster architecture, which is really a bottleneck. So having all your users, you know, accessing this system was, you know, a big problem, and they could not scale with all your users. So generally, these systems are very restricted to only a few users in the company, and or, you know, what happens is companies create silos. So they have, you know, more than one of these systems. They have, you know, several Teradata systems, many Vertica, many Netezza. Big enterprise, they had to do that to scale with users. Saying that, when you don't put a lot of data and when you don't have a lot of users using this system, they are pretty fast to answer. You know, they are very optimized and they can, you know, have good response time. So you get fast answer as long as you don't push the system. And also these systems are true SQL database, which is important, right? The ecosystem is, and the way to query data is SQL, and they are the best at running this SQL language. They have very deep optimization, so they are very efficient at that. And also transaction is important. You know, when you have, you know, to execute your ETL pipeline, you need transaction, you need to be able to roll back if there is a problem, you need to be able to go back in time if your UT version concurrency control, you can go back in time if you need to repair something, if you, you know, your ETL pipeline had an issue. So that's very important characteristics. The new breed of what cloud is, so when we started Snowflake in 2012, there was no, you know, cloud data warehouse system. But now we have many of those. And they really are not fundamentally different than the on-premise ones, right? They were not, you know, designed for the cloud. They were just, you know, ported and hosted and run in the cloud. So they are the same system. I would say they are not as good as their on-premise, you know, counterparts, because the cloud is a much more challenging environment. And they have all the flaws and the benefits also of this EDW on-premise system. Of course, there is the big data, and that was a huge failure of this system. I mean, we knew that, you know, big data systems they were not good, but when, you know, of course, you can store all your data, and they were the only system that could do that, so they could, you know, be a solution for the big data challenge, solution that was not, you know, provided by this, you know, legacy system, but it was a bad solution. So it was a bad solution for a very important, you know, problem. And there are better, you know, scalability in terms of users, number of users, but they are still, you know, single cluster architecture, so they have, you know, a lot of the same limitations. And you know, one of the biggest issues with this system is that they are super hard, you know, to operate and to manage. They are, you know, systems, I always say that, you know, built by engineers, you know, for engineers, and they are not, you know, really designed for, you know, the regular human beings to be used and managed. So very complex, only reserved for the top, you know, enterprise in the world. So big data was not a solution. So, of course, as you can guess, you know, we...
of course.
That wasn't easy. But what's important is what I say, right? Is when you start a startup, you have to find a big problem that was not solved. And that's our big problem that was not solved. And it's a very difficult problem, too. Because if it is very easy to solve it, then everyone is going to solve it, and then you don't have any edge, right? And that's why we fought, and Thierry and I, you know, as I said, for this topic in August 2012, and we said we have to solve this problem, but of course, we didn't know how to solve this. What we knew, though, is that we were going to solve it in the cloud. And that's very critical, because obviously, when you think about all our users, you immediately think about elasticity on demand. And this is the only way to, especially for the old users, you know, challenge, where, as I said, it's very spiky. If you, you know, even if you can scale, but you are always at the top, you know, at the maximum, you know, peak of the workload, you are going to pay a lot more than what you can pay, right? So the only way to solve the whole user challenge is to be really elastic and adapt to the demands and go up and down, you know, like really instantly. So we knew that, you know, only in the cloud you could do that. So also only in the cloud you have, you know, unlimited access to resources, both storage and compute. So the cloud was an obvious answer for us. The other aspect of the cloud that we thought was really appealing is providing a solution as a service. Where, you know, big data solution and Hadoop fail was, as I said, because of the complexity of the system. And as you go with a large system, very complex system, with potentially hundreds of thousands of servers operating in your system, the complexity of managing that system is really huge. And we thought that if we could make a system as a service super easy to use, you know, really easier of that, you know, of using that system than, you know, you just, what we say, load your data and run your queries, and that's the only thing you need to do. The system and the service takes care of everything. If it could be such a system, then the barrier of entry would be far less, far, you know, lower than what it is. And not only, you know, Google and Facebook and this company could use, you know, big data and do analytics, but everyone could do that. And that was really our vision, is to dramatically lower the barrier of entry of complex analytical solutions that everyone could use. So we knew that that we had where we wanted to build, but we had no clue on how to build it. And what we did is I had an apartment on El Camino in San Francisco. And Jerry and I, we spent many months in that apartment. I had made, I bought a whiteboard. I had only my living room to put that whiteboard, so my wife was not that happy with it. But we spent, our days in that living rooms, the first 5 months of conflict, we are there to try to find a solution for that problem. How can we solve this problem? And of course, we had to solve it in a very different way than any other system. So how did we solve that problem? And of course, as you heard many times, this is the architecture. We had to find a very different architecture for Snowflake than any other existing system. This architecture had to be really on demand. When you need resources, you get resources. And when you don't need them, you can release them, and you pay only for what you use. This is the elasticity of the cloud. And so when we started and we thought about it, we said, okay, let's look at traditional architecture and why are they not good? Why is it not going to work if we use this architecture for Snowflake? And as I said, traditional architecture are single cluster. There is one single cluster of machines, and generally this cluster is storing more data at the same time, so it's a very tight relationship between compute and storage. Every node of this cluster store a fraction of the data. And of course, every query that needs to access the data needs to run on this cluster, and every query will touch the nodes where the data is stored. And these nodes have finite capacity, right? And as you pile more and more queries, you will get contention. And now we have to play this amazing game, I call it the Tetris game of workload management. You have to think about which workload is going to run when. My ETL workload, maybe I can delay my ETL workload and run it in the middle of the night, because in the middle of the night, my dashboard is not running anymore. And I can really think about the workload and place this workload at different time, and I have to, of course, know how much this workload needs. And maybe I can find new optimal solution, but very likely, I'm not going to make it, so the workloads are going to contend for resources and they are going to have friction between them. And potentially my system is not going to be large enough, so I will have to have another one. If I want to extend it, it's very hard to, because the data needs to be reshuffled, so there's a long operation, many hours potentially of downtime to execute that operation. So fundamentally, cluster architecture will buy. So if single architecture is not good, then obviously we need a multi-cluster architecture, and that's what we came up with. We need something where you can add as many clusters as you want, but as I said, the elasticity is key. So in Snowflake model, right, imagine that you want to run many workloads, and you have a new workload to run, for example. And what can you do? In the old system, you had to run this workload on the single cluster that was used by all the other workloads. So this is where you think about conversions of resources, and can your workload even fit in whatever leftover capacity there is. In Snowflake, it's a very different model. You get compute resources for your workload. They are dedicated for your workload. This is this cluster, or maybe more than one cluster can be used for one workload. These compute resources are grouped in Snowflake in what we call a virtual warehouse. You can have as many virtual warehouses, it's a virtual warehouse as a size. But what is nice is that when you dedicate compute resources to a workload, now you can size these compute resources exactly the way you need it to run most efficiently that single workload. And it's really easy to size when you know that it's one single workload. This is my ETL workload running. This is what my ETL needs. This is my dashboard. I can dedicate different compute resources for a dashboard workload. And the nice thing too is that you don't contend for resources between these different workloads. The other aspect is that if you dedicate resources and you can allocate these resources really in seconds, and today, at the time when we did Snowflake, we were aiming at minutes, so in 1 or 2 minutes, I can grab compute resources like big clusters. Now in Snowflake, most of the time it takes literally less than 1 second. In less than 1 second, you can have dedicated compute resources to run your workload. And if you do that, why not getting a lot of compute resources, right? It doesn't matter, because the more resources you have, the faster your workload is going to run. Of course, there is, you know, some optimization, it really depends on the workload, but the idea is that more compute resources mean faster execution. When your workload is done, you can shut down, you know, these clusters, and we have, you know, automatically do that. When we detect that nothing is running, we'll shut it down for you. And what is nice is that you pay only what you use in the cloud. So if you use, you know, compute resources for less time, you pay less. Of course, you have more compute resources because you want it to go faster, so you pay more. But at the end, the net is that you can run way faster for the same price. And that's the beauty of that architecture. Of course, it needs to be, you know, really elastic, where you can add and remove and suspend, you know, these different compute resources. So this is a little bit of the detail of that architecture. At the bottom, you see the different cloud providers. We are ported on only three cloud providers. We started with AWS, now, you know, then Azure, and now we just announced, you know, private preview for GCP. We have a layer cloud, what we call the cloud agnostic layer, that allows us to completely abstract through the differences of the various clouds, such that our system above it is completely, you know, cloud agnostic. The central piece of the architecture is the storage. Because we could run several clusters against the same data, we had to decouple data and compute. So we leverage block storage, which is available in every cloud, to store all the data. And the nice attribute of cloud storage is that it's really cheap and it's infinitely elastic. So you never have in Snowflake, you know, a disk full, you know, error. We don't even have this error message. You can never run out of this space because we use, you know, S3 or Azure Blob Storage or GCS, you know, to store all our data. And not only that, but as I said, you know, big data is a very big use case for Snowflake. So when we think about tables, we think potentially of table of petabyte scale. And not only that, but semi-structured data potentially. So Snowflake, you know, can put in the storage layer, you know, semi-structured data at really large, you know, large volume. And there are many customers with several petabytes, you know, in a single table using Snowflake. The inner layer is what we call a multi-cluster compute. So this is what I just explained before. Right, this is the layer which is very, you know, elastic, where you can get, you know, allocate, you know, new clusters, release clusters. We have a pool of, you know, servers ready to go, so it takes, you know, literally seconds to do that, and we charge you by the minutes. And actually, by the second of usage, you have a minimum of 1 minute of usage of your cluster, and then we charge you by the second for that compute stock resources. And then what makes it possible, and as I said, we are a true, you know, database system with transaction, with, you know, full acidity and SQL. The reason why all of this is possible is because of this outer layer in the architecture, which we call the service. And the service is what, you know, runs the transactions of the system. The transactions are not really run by a cluster. And the transaction, you know, management is done in the service layer. And that allows you to have, for example, two different clusters, you know, accessing the same data and synchronizing when they need to update. You can even start a transaction in one cluster and continue it in the next, you know, cluster. And when you commit that transaction, immediately all the clusters which are using that data will see a consistent version of that data that just has been modified. So it's really consistently transactionally consistent, right? And that's very important. So this service layer is where we run, you know, security. Security is very critical for Snowflake. Everything is encrypted. We use, you know, hardware secure modules to do that and to store the keys. Metadata management is performed, you know, in that layer. Data sharing, we talked about this, is also, you know, performed in that layer. So all the management functions are in the service. And the service is the other key aspect of Snowflake. As I said, we wanted Snowflake to be extremely easy to use. And all these functions, so this service layer is smart. it will detect, you know, failure, it will be fault tolerant automatically if you, you know, even if you, all your nodes of your, you know, compute layer are failing at the same time, it will be automatically detected by the service layer, and these nodes will be replaced. Queries will be automatically restarted. You will not see any failure. You will not see any loss of data. So the service is really the place where we have invested a lot and where really we wanted to make it intelligent so that you don't need to spend time managing the system. And on that, I like to say that, you know, think about, you know, all the tasks you do to manage, you know, your database system. First, you have, you know, to set up the infrastructure. You have to do the initial setup, you have to upgrade, you know, the OS, you have to upgrade, you know, your database system, you have to do the patching, you have to plan for capacity, right? You have to plan and make sure that you have enough space, enough compute resources. You have to, you know, think about storage, availability, security is important, right? How you secure, how you, you know, what is your strategy for security. You have to run, you have a strategy for backups. It's not enough, right? You are operating a database system, now you need to think about tables, how you partition this table, how you index them, how you order, you know, the data in this table, how you vacuum, that means you need to have a very strong understanding of the workload that you run. And that's not enough, right? Queries might not run, you know, well, and you might have to tune them, and you have to understand that you need to collect statistics, that you need to manage the memory, that you have to deal with parallelization, how you parallelize, how, you know, you manage the workload. You need to link, you know, your queries. So you need to do all these tasks. And for us, it was really important to remove everything, and it's no thing. Really, what we wanted to build is a system where you don't have to worry about that, because the system is doing it. And the way we do it, as I said, is not to have an army of DBAs behind the scene, you know, operating your workload. It's really the system was built from the ground up, you know, to automatically automate all these management tasks. So I'd like to say a few words on what it enables you, right? You know, Frank was saying it is very transformative, and this is true. In the old days and the existing technology, right, you really think about infrastructure. Someone is building the infrastructure for you, generally this would be your IT departments. It gives that infrastructure to the business, and the business is confined into whatever was set up by the IT departments, and they have to deal with that. And they cannot, you know, do more than what, you know, was allocated to them. It's not that it's completely different. It's the business price what they want to do, and automatically they will, you know, add new workload and enable new things, and they don't need to go through the IT and drive capacity. It's not that they automatically do that. And it has several dimensions, right? The first one is on really the capacity. How big are these systems? As I said, you know, in seconds you can create a warehouse. It's one SQL statement, it's no fake or one click in the UI. And you have a brand new compute system where you can run your new workload. So it's really on-demand elastic, right? That's the new paradigm. You don't have silos and copies of data and stuff like that. That's very critical. You cannot do that, because all the data is centralized. Of course, you cannot organize your data in different databases. You can have as many databases as you want. But database is a logical concept, it's no fact, it's a naming concept. So you can join, you know, two tables of two different databases in the same query. There is no, you know, physical, you know, distribution of data. And so it's really unified, you know, data, you know, store, which case. And the last thing is infrastructure management, as I say. You don't need to worry about that. You know, you can really focus on managing your data. So with that, I want to finish this section by really giving you the idea that SnowFlake is not just an evolution. It's not just the next, you know, version of your traditional, you know, database system. It is really something completely new. And if someone tells you that, oh, in our next version we'll be like SnowFlake, we'll have all these things, it's probably not true, because you have completely to rebuild, you know, from the ground up. The architecture is so different. So, I wanted to have a demo for this keynote, but I couldn't because it's too difficult to operate. So I like to give you, to run through a scenario of what you can do with SnowFlake, just to give it more, you know, visually that you can see. So as I say, first it starts with data. So you could have a snowflake, you know, system where you only have data and you don't have any compute. Of course, you cannot do a lot, but it will be very cheap for you because you will only pay for the number of bytes that you have, you know, stored in Snowflake. Obviously, if you want to ingest new data, you have to have compute. And this is the first, so you can create, as I say, the virtual, you know, warehouse to do the all the ingest and all the ingest and load of data. And you can load, you know, semi-structured data, traditional data. We are not schema on read, so you don't need really, when you have semi-structured data, to define the schema and to say that I have arrays and collections and all of these. You just, you know, use this bind type. And we automatically detect, you know, the shape of the semi-structured data, and we automatically index it, which is very, very important. Semi-structured data in Snowflake is a first-class object. So we do all the optimization that we do for traditional columnar data, we do that on semi-structured data. So we detect all the repetitive, you know, attributes that you have in your JSON documents, and we columnarize them, index them, and I will explain how we index, you know, data. It's a special index, it's not, you know, your traditional index. But that's important. You can have, you know, now a different, you know, set of virtual warehouse to do all your transformation. Oftentimes, as soon as the data lands, you want to further transform that data, maybe compute some aggregation, or maybe, you know, apply this data to another table. So that you can have a dedicated system for that. That will not, you know, impact the triple load that you want to do generally in the streaming way. You can have, you know, different, you know, with virtual warehouse for your different, you know, departments in your enterprise. For example, finance will have their own warehouse, and when they use it, no one will be impacted, and they will not impact, you know, loading or transformation. You can have a different virtual warehouse for your data science. And one aspect which is important is not only you can add and remove, you know, this virtual warehouse in your system, but you can also resize them on the fly. You don't need to stop the workload. You can increase the size. For example, for data science, you can say queries are not performing fast enough. I want to have more nodes in my cluster. So you can increase the size of that cluster, and immediately the queries response time will decrease. And as a, you know, warehouse generally that you are going to have is for your dashboards, right? Queries of dashboards are really high throughputs and very fast. You don't want, you know, to impact them with data science or load or all of that. So you want a dedicated virtual warehouse for your dashboards and your BI. But what happens if for BI is interesting, right? The number of users and the concurrency is going to change over time. You know, at night, very few, you know, users, you know, are going to use that system, maybe zero, and then it will shut down. During the day and in the morning, you have a lot of users concurrently accessing the same, you know, system. So you really want to be able to increase the throughput of that system on the fly. And Snowflake has this multi-cluster warehouse that you can have, so you can configure how many cluster warehouse can have. And automatically Snowflake will add, you know, new clusters as the concurrency, you know, increases, and will remove this cluster as the concurrency decreases. And that allows you to be infinitely scalable with, you know, concurrent queries. So we have many more capabilities, and I'm not going to talk too much about it because I'm running out of time. But one thing which is important is automatic micro-partitioning is one of the big inventions of Snowflake. So automatically we partition the data, and we partition it, we call it micro-partition, because each partition is very tiny. You don't need to define any partitioning scheme in Snowflake. We automatically partition this data in few megabytes, you know, partitions, and we index this partition. It's very important that we index it on every column or every attribute of your JSON documents. We find the distribution of data in each micro-partition, and if you have, you know, petabyte scale table, you can have literally hundreds of millions of partitions, micro-partition in a single table. No one can add that number of partitions. And each of these partitions is indexed such that if you query your petabyte scale table, we exactly know the set of relevant micro-partitions which are relevant for your query based on the predicates. We call that pruning, and we can return literally in such a given, you know, response time, even on the table which is petabyte scale. So this is the way we achieve, you know, really fast response time, even for the big data, you know, use case. cloning is also very, you know, worth calling out. You can clone a petabyte, you know, database. It takes, I did a test, it takes about 1 minute and 30 seconds to create a duplicate of that database. And then this clone, you can, you know, it's copy and write, so you can update any of the objects. It's completely independent of the source, you know, the database. And you can use that for your dev system, your QA, or, you know, for your ETL sometimes. As I said, we are columnar storage. It's very important for analytics. We support time travel, so because we are a transactional system, you can go back in time, of any point of time, and you can recreate, you know, the data and the database at the state it was, you know, 1 hour ago, 12 hours ago. So if you have missed an error in your ETL pipeline, you can recover from this error and replay whatever went wrong. So we have oftentimes people asking us, you know, Snowflake would like more data lake than a data warehouse, and it is true, right? We have this multi-cluster, we have no silo of data, we are very open because we can ingest any format, we have also this unload operation, we can support any number of workloads concurrently against the same data sets, we have very cheap storage, and we have schema on rail. But we are much more than a data lake, because we have many additional benefits. In particular, governance, you know, we are fully transactional, so as I said, we are database and we are ACID. We allow data sharing, we are global, and I will explain what is global Snowflake. We have performance, right? Data lakes are super slow, we are super fast, it's a big difference. And we are managed service, and that's also critical, right? The complexity, you don't need to manage your data lake if you use Snowflake. We do that, you know, for you. So it's very simple to use. So beyond the data warehouse, and this is what I said, you know, we want to rebrand ourselves into more like a data platform, a global data platform. And there are three things that I want to call out: data pipeline, global Snowflake, and secure data sharing. So let's start with data pipeline. As I said, reducing the latency of ingest, you know, the time between the time the data is born in your operational system and the time you can move it to Snowflake and start to query that data, you want to minimize that. And you want that to be, you know, few seconds at the most. So we have few technology for that. We have a serverless service named Snowpipe, where we can automatically load, you know, any incoming data at a very high frequency. So this is a way to ingest data in Snowflake very quickly. And we have two sources of data we can ingest and detect automatically files that you land in the log storage. For example, S3, we detect that data is landed and we automatically move this data. And we have, you know, you define the rules of how to ingest this data, where this data needs to be ingested, in which, you know, stage table, and we do that automatically for you. So it's very easy to use and very high low latency. And we have also, you know, connector with Kafka. It's worth mentioning that, you know, people are sometimes asking, okay, Snowflake is a very closed system, right? That's one of the drawbacks. We are not closed. You can really easily unload data and unload data in any format that you want in a really high scale. And that's important to mention that. Ingest generally is when the data lands, but after the data has landed in this staging table, you need to transform it. And transformation of data inside, you know, Snowflake is very scalable. We support, you know, all the advanced DML, you know, insert, update, delete, multi-table insert, merge. And you can, you know, do this transformation inside Snowflake in a very scalable way. For that, we created this table stream, so you can define this table stream on your data. And table strings are going to detect any change in the staging data or in any intermediate table that you have. And you can, you know, in a transactional way, take these changes that were made since last time you run and run this automated task that, you know, you can schedule whenever you want to move this data and transform it and apply it to a target table. So this is very, you know, very easy to use transformation and very efficient way of transforming data. Another aspect of Snowflake is that we really work hard to augment your existing data lakes. We recognize that many of our customers have started, you know, a data lake, have a data lake, or have a data lake strategy, and we want to make it, you know, easier to use that data lake in the context of Snowflake. So for that, we have, you know, a few things. We have the first concept is external tables. You can define a table in Snowflake, but where the data resides outside, and you can query this data from Snowflake and we'll use all the role-based access control. products and all the efficiency of our query processing engine to create that data. Of course, it's not as efficient as if the data was ingested because we don't have micro-partitioning in this case. We have traditional, you know, fact partitions that you have defined. But it's still, you know, a good way if you don't want to create that data too often. We also have materialized view, what we call materialized view. So Snowflake supports materialized view. You can define materialized view on an external table, so we can materialize automatically an external data set and to, you know, provide this very optimized, you know, query on your external data. So global Snowflake, this is, you know, really critical. The world is moving, of course, to the cloud, and the cloud has many, you know, players. And generally, customers, they don't want to be locked in one solution, in one cloud vendor. So we have 40 Snowflake on all the cloud vendors, so AWS, as I said, Azure, and Google. So first Snowflake is multi-cloud, but more than that, it's multi-region, right? And it's important to say that in the modern world, you are probably have to face the distribution of data, right? If your company is big, it probably has existence in several continents, and you have data in these different continents, and for regulation, you cannot move this data, you know, in a centralized space. So you have to deal with distribution and regulation, and also disaster recovery. If a region fails, you want to be able to fail over. So this is the current map of Snowflake. You can see all the different regions, the different colors of the different cloud providers that we have, and we are expanding this map. You know, literally every, you know, month we create a new region and for different, you know, cloud. But what is important in global Snowflake is when you look at that, it looks like we have installed, you know, different instances of Snowflake a little bit everywhere in the world in different cloud. But it's not true. What these instances are really strongly connected together. We call that, you know, the data mesh between these instances. So they talk to each other. They understand, you know, this map. So you can think of really Snowflake as a virtual multi-cloud data center, which is all over the world, and where you can move data freely between these different, you know, nodes, which are your different cloud region. And you can move data freely between any cloud also. It doesn't matter, we don't care. So you can move data from, you know, Google to Amazon or vice versa, and that's, you know, for data sharing, for example, that might be an important use case. Of course, we also realize that a customer, an organization, as we call them, might have several accounts in different regions. So we have this concept of organization that we are rolling out, and where your organization can have accounts, you know, for example, Amazon accounts in the United States, but you might use Azure in Europe, and we understand that all these accounts are connected by the same organization. Therefore, you can move data between these accounts, and this is the foundation of replication. So when you want to replicate between your accounts, you can move data, you know, cross-region between two of your accounts, for example, in the United States, but you can also move this data cross-continents, you know, it doesn't really matter. And you can move this data also, you know, cross-cloud. And this is really easy to do that in Snowflake. You really create a replica, a new refresh, and your data is moved. And we do that very efficiently. You can move petabytes, and we have, you know, a few customers that have moved really petabytes of data between regions. One thing which is very important is business continuity in this context. So one reason to replicate data beyond data sharing is to implement business continuity. And then there, what you need to do is to define a primary, you know, version of your data, your primary copy. And if you have a failure, you want to fail back. And when you fail back, of course, you want all the connections of your clients to automatically move to the failover, you know, replica. And we have this client redirection objects where you can control that automatically from the back end. And you want your clients that they will automatically reroute their traffic to the surviving, you know, region. Secure data sharing, so very quickly, as I'm running out of time. So data sharing is really, I would say, a benefit of our architecture, right? Our multi-cluster architecture is shared data architecture, meaning every cluster can potentially access any data which is stored in our, you know, storage, in the storage layer. Of course, by default, you cannot access data outside of your account. Right? It's you can think of it as a firewall. But with data sharing, you can create a secure database share and grant access to another account to your data. And it's a direct access, right? There is no copy involved. And you can see that in that picture at the bottom. The account on the right has created the secure database share and is accessed by a cluster, which is on the left side, which is a consumer account. So you don't need to provision, you know, compute resources to get to provide access to your data. You just need to create the secure database share and grant access to the secure database share to any accounts in the same region as yourself. And what is important to mention is data sharing is really secure with Snowflake. You don't need to FTP, you know, data, and you don't need to copy data and define, you know, encryption that we share with another, you know, party. It all stays inside Snowflake. It's really light, so if the provider updates their data and commits, as soon as they commit, the consumer will see the change that has been committed, as if they had directly, you know, they were running in your system. It's frictionless because it's very easy. You don't need to think about it. You just run OTL and automatically your data will be propagated. And for consumers, it's really easy, especially with the data exchange concept. Right? You can go and for example, you know, get this data from Braze and say, I want this database from Braze to be my account. And as I said, you can join any data from any database to any other data. So you can join this data that you want with your own data, which is, you know, where it's very powerful. Not only you can access external data, but you can join it with your own data. It's personalized potentially, so this database, this secure share, can be really created for you, and it will filter and show you only the data which is relevant to you and that you have access. So you can, you know, really share different data sets with different consumer without really, you know, creating different data sources. And it's just a view with different filter predicates on top of your data so that you don't expose, you know, what you don't want to expose. And it's global because, of course, you can move your data to different regions, different cloud, and you can share that, you know, that data locally. So it's very easy for someone to share data, you know, to whoever across the world with replication. So, as Frank was mentioning it, we have this data exchange, so we realized that it was hard to know who has data, who can share it, so we did this exchange, and you can think of the exchange as a little bit the upper store of Snowflake. So this is our data store, where you can see the catalog, and you can say, oh, I'm interested in this, I want weather data, because, you know, I'm in the business of tourism, and I need to know weather all over the world, and historical, and let me get this weather data, or, you know, price data, marketing data. A lot of our customers have asked us, they were so excited with the public exchange that they wanted, you know, as Frank was saying, the private version of the exchange, you know, both because they are potentially a big organization that needs to share internally data between the different business units or the different departments, but also because they are in a vertical where, you know, their customers, you know, want to have access to their data, so they want to create, you know, this exchange, but just for their industry, right? And between their customers, their partners, and their supplier. So private exchange is not yet released. We are, you know, working on it, and it will be probably, as Frank was saying, you know, end of the year, November, December. So on that, I'm going to conclude. Hopefully, you could see where we started with this vision of building a data warehouse, you know, really for the cloud, and that can scale, that can put all your data. But slowly, we converted ourselves to really being a data platform. And what is very important is that platform, you know, the data is global, is covering, you know, all the regions and all the clouds. So don't think of your data in one, you know, location. You know, potentially it's everywhere in every cloud, and it can move. So it's free from moving. It's very secure. Security is a super important aspect of Snowflake. We realize that we never did a service in the cloud if we were not, you know, really secure and encryption. And as I said, there's a lot of features there. And of course, your data, when I say your data, all your data is not only your data, but it's also data that you get in data sharing in that universe. You really want to combine your data with external data to know how you are doing and all this. And this is a public exchange and of course a private exchange. So on this, thank you very much for your time. And sorry for you.
Please welcome Michael Keaton back to the stage.
So as you saw here today in the first half of the session, is we've had some just absolutely great presentations this morning. But the thing that we saw just now is when you look at Embrace with Snowflake, you have the opportunity, because it is as a service, to have an unbelievable operational impact in your business. You have the ability to kind of transform how you get the data insights in a new way, whether they're yours or shared with a customer or another part of your business unit. You're able to go out to these other peaks that I talked about earlier in the discussion and bring those back and actually join those together and get insights from your own data, the mountain that you're on, and other customer data and the mountains they provide that you have. And lastly, you had a customer experience in Braze that talked about how we actually made a business impact for them and how they actually operate their business on a day-to-day basis. So as we break for lunch, we leave from 12 to 1:30, a couple of housekeeping changes-wise. One, the panelist discussion, which will be a customer panelist discussion, will actually start at 12:30 rather than 12:45 in the brochure. So we'll start at 12:30, you will be here. The people that are gonna stay for that panelist discussion, we will actually serve you lunch here. Those who want to go see the partner based exhibits and want to participate in the partner based exhibits, that will be over where you registered this morning. You'll actually go across the other side of the pier, nice walk back to come to all the exhibits that are all the tracks we're going to do. So as I said to you earlier, there's going to be a bunch of people that are wandering around here that have the Snowflake shirts on. They are your ambassadors for the day to make sure that you can actually get to the right venue that you need to, or the right track that you want to go down, whether it be the green, the blue, or the black diamonds that you want to go through. I appreciate everybody's attendance. I appreciate you guys investing the time to learn a little bit more about us, and look forward to seeing you. Most importantly, when you get down to the bottom of that, at the end of the track, 4:20, go get a cocktail. So make sure you have your cocktail before you take off. Thank you, everybody.